Praise the Lord. Isn't it good to be with you today here on What the World Needs is Jesus. Yeah. Hallelujah. Right. Friend, we need the Lord Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. I can gladly say that I know the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. Friend, if you don't know Jesus, I urge you to find you an altar. Go ahead and do it now. Go ahead and get right with God now. Yeah. That way you can enjoy the rest of this service. Because I'm telling you what, we're going to worship the Lord today. Amen. We're going to let God have his way. Let the Holy Ghost come on down and have his way. Amen. Praise the Lord. And we're just going to let God just be God. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. I want to make just a few announcements before we get started here. We're going to have a Holy Ghost meeting now. Yeah. Listen to me. Holy Ghost meeting over in Gurley, Alabama. I know y'all know where Gurley is. Our vicinity here is kind of right close, goes right up close to Gurley. So we're going to be in Gurley, Alabama on the 25th of this month, which will view on Sunday. So that will be the following Tuesday. It will be Tuesday. The 25th, we're going to be at 6:30. We're going to be at Gurley there. It's 1169 Highway 72 East in Gurley, Alabama. That's Tuesday evening at 6:30. We're going to be there at 6:30. So we want you to come. Now, that is at an auction building. That is Brother Larry and his mother owns the auction building there. They own the auction there. And we decided that we have auctions on Friday and Saturday night, so we decided we just have a little church through the week there. I don't know. Ain't nothing wrong with that, are they? And then we're just gonna have us a good old Holy Ghost meeting there. And on Tuesday, now that's there at the auction. If you're going down Highway 72, and you see, and you look over, and if you get close, you can get close to 1169 Highway 72 there. When you look around and you'll see all the red buildings. You can't miss it. If you find the red buildings, you can't miss it. There's also a lighted sign there that says auction on it. And I might be able to talk Brother Larry into putting on up there. We're going to have church meeting on that Tuesday. And that way, you know, you can tell it by that. But if you see the red buildings, you can't miss it. You'll find it. That's it right there where the red buildings is at. And we want to invite everybody to come. I know for some folks it may be a long way, and some folks it may not. Some folks may live right around, you know, in the Stevenson, Scottsboro area and stuff. That, you know, it's just not far right over there to Gurley. So just come on over there and be with us on the 25th. That's Tuesday the 25th at 6:30. A good old Holy Ghost. We're just going to turn loose and let the Holy Ghost of God have his way, and just let the Lord, amen, have his way, and see what the Lord wants to do. Also, I want to let you know that Pentecostal Power Ministry, Sister Debbie, Brother Steve and Sister Debbie, they are Pentecostal Power Ministries. They also, Sister Debbie's going to be preaching for us, by the way, after a while, here in a little bit. Her and Brother Larry, they're going to bring us the word after a while. We're going to let Brother Ricky sing and Sister Shantae sing, and then we just got it figured out. But you know what? If the Lord was to say we don't want it that way, we'll do it however the Lord wants to do it. Amen. We're just here to please the Lord. But Brother Steve and Sister Debbie and Pentecostal Power Ministry, they also going to be over there with us Tuesday. They're going to try their best to be over there with us Tuesday. I'm telling you, folks, we're just going to have church is what I'm talking about. Yeah. That's what we're there for, amen, to worship the Lord, have church. See people's needs get met. You may need a healing, or you may need maybe you're not saved and you just need to get saved. Amen. We especially want you to be there. Amen. Amen. Come and get saved, or maybe you backed up on the Lord. I don't know. Just come and get your needs met. God loves you, folks, and God wants you to get your needs met. Amen. We need to get our needs. Brother Steve and Sister Debbie, Pentecostal Power Ministries, are over at, where am I at? Over at Larley, Alabama.
Georgia.
Larley, Georgia. I got Alabama wrote down here. I'm in Alabama now. Larley, Georgia. Now that I live up on Lookout Mountain up there by the Canyon Land Park over there, and that's about 25 minutes from my house. So it's, you know, some folks it may be a long way, like if you live at Gurley or Scottsboro or something like that. But for some folks it may not be too far. We'd like to invite you to come over and be with us over there at Pentecostal Power Ministry. Brother Steve and Sister Debbie's the pastor over there. And we'd like you to come over there and be with us. Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock worship, and then Sunday nights at 6 o'clock, and then Thursday nights at 7 o'clock. Now, this is all Georgia time. Alabama, back it up an hour. If it's 6 o'clock, it's going to be 5 o'clock in Alabama. So this is all Georgia time. But I'd like to invite you to come and be with them over there, with us over there. We go over there, too. We're over there, too. At Pentecostal Power Ministries at Larley, Alabama. Larley, Georgia. I'm sorry. Larley, are they Larley, Alabama? Good. That way nobody can't go Larley, Alabama. So I thought, Brother Ronnie said it was over here. Larley, Georgia. And it's on, what's the name of that? Larley Dam Road.
Yeah.
It's on Larley Dam. Now, if you ever been to Larley, I know you can't get lost in Larley. I know you can't. Because if you go around the block, you'll come right back out on the main road right there where you is at. So you just, when you get to Larley there, you just look up Larley Dam Road right there. It's right across where the dollar store and all that's at and everything. And just come on over and be with it. Boy, we've been having some good Holy Ghost meetings over there too. Just been letting God have his way. We've just been having some good times in the Lord, and we just want to let you in on it. Hallelujah. Because God is real, and God loves you today, and God wants to move upon you, and God wants to meet your needs today. Whether or not, I don't care what the devil's told you, God loves you and God wants to meet your needs. And I'm glad to say today that we're serving a great big old God. We're serving a God today. Did you know we're serving a risen God? Woo, glory. He's alive and well today, and he's still blessing. He's still healing. Yeah. He's still raising from the dead. Yeah. He's still alive, glory to God, and he's still doing what he used to do. I mean, if it was good for my grandma, it's good for me. Hallelujah. Yeah. And it'll be good for my children too. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I'm just so glad, amen, to be a Christian, be a born-again child of God.
Yes.
On my way to heaven, glory to God. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go away, I will. Positive statement right there. Nothing about I might or maybe if you do this or that. He said, I will. He's coming back. He will be back. Amen. And he's coming back after you and I, amen. Those that's watching and ready. You say, Brother Ronnie, I'm watching and ready. If you don't know him, you can't be watching for him. Come amen. On. You got to know Jesus. You got to have that personal relationship with Jesus. Just check up, folks. Make sure you got it. Make sure you're going to heaven. I want everybody to go to heaven with me. Hallelujah. That can. Praise the Lord. Now we want you to worship with Brother Ricky as he comes around and sings, This World Is Not My Home. Brother Ricky.
This world is not my home. I'm only passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond.
Well, glory to God. Praise Didn't you enjoy Lord. That song with Brother Ricky Phillips? Hallelujah. You know, I'm feeling the Lord this morning. Yes. Hallelujah. Oh, I am so glad to be here and so glad to be about my Father's business. You know, Brother Ronnie was talking about the meeting that we're going to have in Gurley, Alabama.
Yeah.
Praise God. I'm looking to see something great go on for those people. Lord, if you're hungry, if you're in whatever you're in need of, come on out and be with us, because we serve a God. We serve a God that will not fail us. We serve a God that can save us, can heal us, can deliver us, can meet our needs. So whatever need you have, if you're lost and undone without God, if you're sick and need a healing, come on out and be with us in Gurley, Alabama.
Yes,
what day again? The 25th?
Yes.
Tuesday the 25th. You know I'm looking forward to it. I'm telling you, I just know that I know that I know that there's nothing impossible for God. If you got a need, come on and be with us. Because I'm trusting God's going to do something great. I feel it in my spirit. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm telling you, this place is anointed, Brother Ronnie. When you get up behind here, you feel the Lord. I'm telling you, because I believe when this goes out and people watches this, someone's in need of something. And God gives us the word. One of the ministers up here, the one speaking, God will give us the word to meet that need for somebody out there. Somebody out there that's hungry. Somebody out there that's lost. Somebody's out there that's at the end of their rope, and they don't know which way to turn or which way to go. And they'll flip on that TV station, and they'll hear the word, and it'll go right out and go into their hearts and meet the need that they have. Oh, hallelujah. Woo, hallelujah. Oh, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Galatians 5, 16, and 17. And it said, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh.
Amen.
For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would." Uh-huh. Hallelujah. You know, and I looked that up in the Amplified Bible, and it says, "But I say to walk and live in the Spirit." Hallelujah. Yeah. We can walk and live in the Spirit. And it says, controlled and guided by the Spirit. Don't you want to be controlled and guided by the Spirit of God? To walk that walk that we need to walk. And it says, "And then you will certainly not gratify the cravings and the desires of the flesh." You know, I was talking to a young man yesterday, and he really has a lot of problems with drugs and pain medication. And I was talking to him yesterday, and he said, "I want the Lord to deliver me." He said, "I've done all that I know to do." And he said, "I need God to deliver me. I need God to step in. And I need him to help me." And he's been struggling with this for such a long time. And I told him, I said, "We are going to pray for you." I said, "We're going to pray for your deliverance." I said, "But we're going to pray that the desire be gone." Because, you know, it's the flesh desires these things of the world. Our flesh desires it. And I said, "We're going to pray that the desire will be gone. That way it can make way for deliverance." Hallelujah. Because I'm trusting God, he's going to deliver this young man. Because this young man has got to work for God, and he tries, and he'll go for a while, and then he seems to stumble. But praise God, I'm trusting that God is going to deliver him. He's going to take away that desire, that he's going to be walking in the Spirit. Walking in the Spirit and not in the flesh. Oh, hallelujah. You know, if we feed the Spirit and not the flesh, then we're winners. Hallelujah. But I'm going to tell you one way to feed the Spirit is by the things that we listen to on the radio and the things that we watch on TV. You know, there was that little saying growing up, you know, and it was talking about milk does the body good and all this, and it says you are what you eat. Well, let me tell you, you are what you listen to, and you are what you watch. Hallelujah. What goes in here goes in here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, I was watching a movie one night called War Room. I don't know how many of you have seen that movie. But at the end of that movie, I'm telling you, I was feeling the Lord when she was talking about, "Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up, Lord." Hallelujah. We need to be raised up. We need a nation that needs to be raised up for the Lord. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you, I felt the Lord, and my spirit was just singing. Hallelujah. worldly movie made me feel that way? If I'd have watched some of the garbage that's on TV, and I know a lot of people, that's all they're able to do is watch TV. Well, praise God, turn it over to something that's going to glorify the Lord. Turn it over to something that's going to glorify your spirit. Feed into your spirit. It's like what you listen to on the radio. I've had people come around and talk about this song or that song, and, you know, well, it's new, it's number one. I'm like, if it's not gospel, I don't know. I don't know the song. I don't listen to that stuff. I'm telling you, let me tell you how we can feed that our spirits. When our flesh gets weak and we have a battle. I went to a battle a few years ago, and I'm telling you, I was just so brokenhearted. I was hurt by someone that I cared about so much. And I remember going down the road, and I was just so broken, and my spirit was feeling it. But my flesh was hurting, and my flesh was trying to rise up and be angry. My flesh wanted to be angry. My spirit was mourning, but my flesh was angry. And I remember driving down the road, and I was just beside myself, and I cut on the radio. And the song that was playing was The Anchor Holds. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! And you know what? I just started singing along with that song in my car. And the next thing you know, I started feeling the Lord. And guess what? Guess what? My victory came. I was able to forgive this person that hurt me. And I was able to love that person that hurt me. Why? Because I started walking in the Spirit and not the flesh. And you know, are there times I get frustrated, Brother Larry? Yeah, there's times I get frustrated. Just this morning, I was reading my word and getting my message together, you know, and writing stuff down, and I was coming down the road, and I was just feeling the Lord and had my gospel music going, and this car pulled out in front of me, and they should have got over in the turning lane, and they just pulled out in front of me. I almost hit them. And at first thing, the flesh wanted to get angry, like, what are you doing? And I said, devil, you're not going to win this victory. And I just lifted my hands. I said, thank you, Jesus. And you just protect those people in that car. Hallelujah. That's what we need to do. When the devil tries to come, you know, the works of the flesh are hatred and anger and bitterness and unforgiveness. Oh, my. I think unforgiveness is one of the main things of the flesh that can destroy us, can destroy our walk with God. Is that unforgiveness?
Yes.
I'm telling you, if someone has hurt you, if someone has betrayed you, if someone has done you wrong, give it to God.
Yes.
Give it to God and let God take care of it. He tells us to pray. Pray for those that despitefully uses us. And I think when they despitefully uses us, they do it on purpose. They do it on purpose. They do it to hurt us and to tear us down. God tells us to pray for them. Oh, hallelujah. And when we start praying for them, guess what? We're walking in the Spirit, Brother Ronnie. We're letting God take control of this. And every single time, God will do it. When we give it to Him, God will do it. You know, I sing a song at church, and it's the song I sing, it says, I've got Jesus on my mind. Oh, hallelujah. It says, Jesus, 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 I've got Him on my mind. It says, when I wake up in the morning, I've got Him on my mind. When my heart is troubled, I've got Him on my mind. Hallelujah. If we wake up in the morning with Jesus on our mind, if we go to bed at night with Jesus on our mind, Brother Larry, I'm telling you, we are going to see God move in our lives. We're going to have that joy that's unspeakable and full of glory because I got Jesus on my mind. I've said this in church when I sang this song. If we've got Jesus, if we've got Jesus on our mind, there is no room for hatred. There is no room for bitterness. There is no room for anger. Oh, hallelujah. There is no room for disobedience if we've got Jesus on our mind. Oh, because that just walks hand in hand with walking in the flesh. I mean, walking in the Spirit and not in the flesh, brother. Because we got Jesus on our mind. Oh, hallelujah. We're not going to want to do those things that our flesh wants to do. When we got Jesus, Jesus on our mind, we are walking in the Spirit. Hallelujah. Oh, I praise you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. things. I wrote down some other things that helps us to keep walking in the spirit and not in the flesh. Woo! In James 5 and 16, it says, the effectual, fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. That tells me when we stay in prayer, we're going to get the job done. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Are you a man or woman? Are you a man or a woman that prays?
Yes.
Prays effectually.
Yes.
Prays fervently. Stays in prayer. You know, you may ask me, well, how can you stay in prayer all day long? You can. You can. You can be talking to the Lord every minute of the day, around the house, as we're cleaning the house, as we're driving our car, as we're driving our car to work, to home, to shopping. We can be talking to the Lord. Hallelujah. We can be telling about our needs. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. In 1 Thessalonians 5 and 17, it says, pray without ceasing.
There you go.
That's just what I said. We can pray continually without ceasing.
Come on, praise the Lord.
You know, there's
praise
things, the Lord. Me and Brother Ricky was talking before the program, and there's things that we can pray for, and it'll happen right then.
Yes.
And there's other things that we have to pray for. It may take a little while.
Exactly right. Amen.
Yeah. But you know what? Even with Lazarus, they thought that Jesus was 4 days late. Church, I'm telling you, he was right on time.
Yeah.
Woo! He was right on time. He will always be right on time for our needs. I got a little testimony I have to share. The ones that go to church with me, they know how I am. But, you know, I'm in love with Jesus. I'm in love with Jesus because he's my healer. He's my protector.
Yes.
He's my provider.
Yes.
Oh, hallelujah. He is the glory and the lifter of my hand.
Yes.
He is my hiding place.
Yeah.
He is my refuge in the time of storm. He is my buckler. He is the one that raises me up when I'm down. He is my everything, and he is my all. Back last month, I think it was the 16th of last month, I had went to a salon to get my hair done. And my daughter is the one that works on my hair, and I was sitting there, and we were talking and stuff. Well, I had not realized that my foot had fallen asleep. So when I got up out of the chair and I started around the chair to hug my daughter, my foot rolled with me, and it was painful. The little girl at the shop said she couldn't, all I could do was laugh. I either could laugh or cry, one or the other, and I chose to laugh. And my daughter's the same way, the little girl at the shop. She said, now I know where Kobe gets that from. She can get hurt and she'll just laugh, you know. But I was sitting there and my daughter said, Mama, do you need to go to the hospital? I said, no, I'm fine. So she helped me to my car. Well, when I got in my car, I realized there was something more than just that I bruised it. So I had to go to the emergency room, and I had broken a bone in the side of my foot and tore two ligaments, one on the top of my foot and one up the side of my ankle. And they put me in like this little temporary cast, and then I went back and they had it in a boot. Now, mind you, this has been about a month ago. And I was walking on crutches. I was on that boot walking on crutches, one in church knows, and then my husband fixed me up this little, motorized little chair that he'd take to church where I could put around in the church. And I think it was last Thursday night, I told him at church, I said, you know, I may still have the boot and everything on. I said, I'm healed.
Yes.
It's just taking my flesh a little time to catch up.
Amen.
But I'm healed. I'm healed. Well, this Thursday before last. And I went back to the doctor last Wednesday, and he said, well, I want you to keep the boot on, but I want you to slowly, gradually, for over the next 3 weeks, take the boot off when you can and try to walk a little bit. But if it's painful, you know, put the boot back on. Well, praise God. Like I told him at church, I was healed.
Yes.
It was just taking a little bit for my time for, you know, my flesh to catch up. The very next morning, Brother Larry, I was walking without the crutches. Hallelujah. And now I'm walking. I haven't had that boot on since I went to the doctor. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's the God I served. He touched me. And he gave me a testimony. You know, I didn't get that healing right off, but praise God, I've got a testimony. Hallelujah. see, I got a testimony from it. I serve a God that will never fail us. I serve a God that all we have to do is call on Him. Oh, hallelujah. Don't you love Him this morning? Don't you just love Him this morning? Oh, and in Psalms 102, it says, serve the Lord with gladness. Oh, yeah. Oh, hallelujah. Are you serving the Lord with gladness this morning? If you're not, then there's something wrong. You need to check your spirit, and you need to get with Jesus and have a little talk with Jesus, like the song says. Yeah. It says, serve the Lord with gladness and come before His presence with singing. Oh, hallelujah. If we have a happy heart, you know that singing makes us happy. Singing makes us happy. And we go before the Lord with gladness and come before His presence with singing. Hallelujah. We'll be in the presence of the Lord. Oh, isn't that wonderful? Don't you just love that feeling when you're just going about your day, like we was talking about, riding in your car, or just going about your day, and you just start singing, you start talking to the Lord, and you feel His presence.
Yes.
You feel His presence. Well, let me tell you, as easily as you feel Him, that's how easily He can move in your life. That's how easily He can save you, fill you, deliver you, heal you, as easily as you feel Him. You know, the Word says where two and three are gathered together. Oh, hallelujah. In my name, there I am in the midst of them. He tells us He's right there in our midst. He's in our midst. So if He's in our midst, that means He's going to move in our problems. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This is one of my favorite scriptures also. It's Psalms 34 and 1. It said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Hallelujah. Think about that scripture. And take that where it says I and replace it with your own name. Debbie will bless the Lord at all the times. And God's praise will be in my mouth. Continuously. He will always be. You know, He's my Savior. You know, a lot of people think, well, she probably don't go through anything, but I go through trials. I sure do. I go through trials. I go through heartaches.
Come on.
You know what? I know the answer. I know the answer that will bring me through those trials and will heal my broken heart when I'm brokenhearted. I have the answer, and His name is Jesus. Oh, His name is Jesus. Hallelujah. You know, if we continually praying, praising, worshiping, and serving the Lord, we will be walking in the Spirit.
Right.
Hallelujah. We will deny the lust of the flesh.
Right.
When we're continuously praying and praising and worshiping, our spirit man takes over and our flesh man has to step aside.
Yeah, right.
Oh, hallelujah. It has to step aside when we're in the presence of the Lord.
Yeah.
You know, I want to continuously walk in the Spirit. I know sometimes the flesh wants to rear up and be contrary at sometimes. But praise God, all I have to do is just call on Jesus and start praying and start worshiping and start singing. And before you know it, that little thing that had been troubling me, it's gone. It's gone. It's gone. You know, this past Sunday, there was a little incident that happened with one of my granddaughters. And we were just so upset because of things that she was going through. And she was hurt and brokenhearted. And you know, as a grandmother, it's hard to see our children or our grandchildren suffering and being mistreated by others.
Amen.
But you know what? I know what Grandma wanted to do. But I knew what Jesus wanted me to do. Hallelujah. And I just turned that situation over to God. And God started moving in it. Now, if I'd have let my flesh got in the way and got contrary and called the person up and said, now, you don't need to be doing my grandchild this way. My flesh would have got in the way. And my flesh would have been contrary.
Yes.
And then this situation wouldn't have worked out. Now it's working out, brother. Now, what the devil took for evil, oh, hallelujah, God turned it around for the good. Oh, isn't He an awesome, almighty God? with one more scripture before my time's up. And it says, every morning, if you get up, there's a scripture that you can recite every morning. Uh-huh. And it's Psalms 118, 24.
There it is.
And it said, this is the day. This is the day which the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, hallelujah. I will rejoice and be glad in it. God created this day. This is a brand new day for this old girl. And I'm telling you, guess what? I'm going to rejoice and I'm going to be glad in it. I'm going to say, God, what do you want me to do today? Instead of saying, God, what can you do for me? I want to start my day saying, God, what can I do for you today? Send the lost to me. Let me tell somebody about Jesus. Let me tell somebody about his love, about his forgiveness, about his glory. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, I thank him this morning, Sister Sharon. He is so good to me. And I'm going to sum it up and say, what the world needs is Jesus. What the world needs is Jesus. Because if we have Jesus, we have everything. We are the richest people in the world when we have Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I want y'all to worship with Miss Shantae Dalton as she comes to sing. God bless each and every one of you, and I hope you have a blessed day. Thank you, Jesus.
I'll write myself a simple song, get the whole world to sing along. Call it a love song for you. And who knows, I'm liable to take a song from the Bible. Then when I'm through, I'll just say, love lifted me. Searching their mind, trying to find the one of a kind way they could say something new. But I'll just say, love lifted me. Oh, love lifted me. Lifted me.
the Lord God Most High. Boy, I'm telling you what, we serve an awesome and a mighty God who is able. You understand, we have a need-meeting God. He's not just able, He's well able. It does not matter what the problem is. It doesn't matter what the doctor said, what the lawyer said. It doesn't matter what the judge said. The only thing that matters is what the Bible says and whether or not we choose to believe that out there or this right here.
Amen.
Now, before I get started, Sister Deborah, I'm glad you came. You came that close to start preaching. I want you to know that. And I needed to hear every word that you had to say.
Yes.
That just sat with me. That was just right. I was a little unsettled today. But you know what? You see, when you make up your mind to say, you know what? I'm going to hear the word.
Yeah.
I'm going to sit under a preacher or before a preacher or in front of a pastor, someone who has a heart for God and someone who preaches the word. If you'll do that, if you'll submit yourself to the word, God will change it.
Yeah, He will.
Amen. There's no ifs, ands, or buts. What about this? What about that? God will change it, bar none. He's never failed, didn't fail yesterday, hadn't failed today.
Right.
I can assure you, if I'm on this earth tomorrow, He'll not fail me.
That's right. Amen.
Now y'all go with me to Matthew. We're going to Matthew 17:17. Going to talk a little bit about something we all need, got to have, and that's called faith. You understand?
Yes.
Matthew 17:17 says, "Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him hither to me." Talking about a little boy that had possessed of a demon. Jesus rebuked the devil. He departed from him. Child's cured about an hour. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart. You see, the disciples was a little ashamed. They didn't want to get up there and ask Jesus in front of a crowd, how come we couldn't do it? When they got alone with Jesus, here's what they done. They said, why could not we cast him out? And you know what Jesus said? When a situation like that comes up, same thing he always says, because of your unbelief. If you'll research in there, do you know Jesus, what he called a hard heart? He called it unbelief. When they got over there and had the fishes and the loaves and they got on the boat and they didn't carry no bread with them, they said, he's mad at us because we didn't carry no bread. He said, no, your heart is hard because you don't believe what I said. If you think today, you go, well, he's got a hard heart. Yeah. Bible says a hard heart means you don't believe God.
Uh-huh.
That's what Jesus called. Get over and look at it.
Yeah, it is. Come on.
And Jesus said, because of your unbelief, for verily or truly I say unto you, if you have faith, I want to know, have you got faith?
Yeah.
Have you been using your faith?
Everybody.
If you're going to use your faith, you're going to speak the word and you're going to stand on the word.
Everybody.
If you had faith, if you don't get born again, you'll get faith. In fact, he gives you faith to get born again. Over in, I believe it's in Hebrews, he said, every man given the measure. He didn't say a measure. If he had said a measure, that means everybody got a different portion. He said the measure of faith. In other words, it's almost like there's this spiritual machine here. It's a dispenser. And every time somebody gets saved, it pops out the measure of faith and it comes down on them. When Paul got born again on the road to Damascus, let me tell you something. You got the same amount of faith he did.
Come on. Amen.
You understand? Look and see what Paul did.
Yeah.
Read about his life story. Everything he did, you have the ability to do and greater.
Come on, brother.
Yes. Hallelujah.
He said, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say, you know, he didn't say you might get around to it when you feel like it. Wait till tomorrow at 2:00. You shall say, you shall say unto this mountain, remove hence into yonder place. It shall remove.
Yes.
He didn't say it shall be removed. He said it shall remove. And what? Nothing shall be impossible to you. Did he not say, did he just not tell me that nothing be impossible? I don't need to move no mountains in Tibet. What I need to do is pray for those people over there. What I need to do, the situation that I'm going through, I need to be speaking to it. And I need to stand on it come hell or high water. Do you understand? You've got to stand your ground this day.
Yes.
You've got to make up your mind who's your God and who you serve, and you better not be ashamed of your God.
Amen.
Now I'm just going to tell you, If you're ashamed of him, what did he say? I'll be ashamed of you. I'd rather you be hot or cold. One of the two. Don't straddle the fence. I'll spit you out.
Come on,
right. Listen, let me tell you something right now. The last thing you want is for God to spit you out of his mouth. That ain't a good thing.
That's right.
Okay?
Tell it right.
Come on. Let's see. Remits, be impossible to you. How be it this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Let me get my note here. Now we're going to back up Matthew 9. I'm telling you, the Bible is so filled with so much faith, it just amazes me.
Yep,
the Jesus that I serve, he never once said, my faith made you whole. Don't think he ever said. Not one time did Jesus said, hey guys, I'm going to heal this guy with my faith. Y'all watch this. Never said that.
Right.
Matthew 9:21. Now y'all know this, the account, the woman with the issue of blood. We're going to start Matthew 9:21. For she said within herself, now here's where this woman's faith is. She said, if I may do something, if I may do some type of physical act, if I can get up from where I am and stop sitting there and having a pity party after these 12 years, blowed all my money to a bunch of liars, and now if I may but touch his garment, I shall be whole. Let me tell you something. That required something of her. Do you understand? She couldn't just sit there and say, oh, woe is me. Well, Lord, I thought you'd heal me here about 10:23, and it's 10:24.
Come on, that's good. Amen.
Amen.
She got up.
Yes, she did.
Yeah.
The woman got up and said, if I may but touch his garment, I shall be made whole. Jesus turned about, and when he saw her, he said, daughter, be a good comfort. Thy faith made thee whole.
Yes.
You understand? Jesus was walking. He was thrown by some folks. He may have been walking slow. He was on his way to heal a little girl. Faith stopped him in his tracks and turned him around.
Yes.
The creator of everything that was, is, and ever will be stopped live in his tracks and turned around because of faith. If he'll do that for her, he'll turn in him in his tracks.
Yes.
He'll turn for you in your faith.
Yes.
He will. I'm telling you, he did it for her. He's no respecter of persons, but let me tell you something. He is a respecter of principle. He's a respecter of those that live and follow his word. He's a respecter of those that do what he said to do. He's a respecter of those that live the way he said to live.
Come on. Yep.
And when Jesus came into the ruler's house, saw the minstrels and the people making noise, he said unto them, give place, for the maid's not dead, but sleepeth. They laughed him to scorn. But when the people were put forth, when the doubt and unbelief got out of there, let me tell you something. If you're in there and you're trying to build your faith and you've got doubt and unbelief around you, I'm not telling you to throw anybody out of your home. You understand what I am telling you to do is you need to get to a place all by yourself and begin to cry out to God.
Yes.
We're going to find out in just a minute what it means when somebody cries out to God.
Amen.
Even though there's a bunch of folks that hush, you ought to hush all that up. This old boy cried the louder. We're going to get there. You just watch this. But when the people were put forth, he went in, took her by the hand, and the maid arose, and the fame hereof went abroad into all that land. And when Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying and saying, thou son of David, have mercy on us. Now let me tell you something. They wasn't right up close to where he was. It says, let me read this again. And when Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying. I don't know as if they had tears. I believe they was hollering at the top of their lungs.
Yeah.
They were crying, Jesus, come and save me, heal me, fix my eyes.
Yeah.
Thou son of David, have mercy on us. And when he was coming to the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said, what can I do for you?
Yeah.
He said, believe you that I'm able to do this. Believe ye. He asked the blind man, he said, do you think I'm able to heal you or not?
Yeah.
They said two words. Yea, Lord.
No,
that's all they said.
Thank you, Jesus.
Believe you that God's able to heal you. They didn't run a whole dissertation about, Lord, I don't know. This is why I'm blind. This is what happened. You don't know what kind of man I am. And you don't know where I've been and what I've done and what I've been thinking. They didn't say that.
Come on.
What they Jesus asked him a question. He said, believe ye that I am able to do this? Question mark.
Yeah.
They said unto him, yea, Lord, period.
Amen.
Period. Yeah. Yes, Lord, I believe.
Yeah.
You know what happened? Then touched he their eyes, saying, according to your faith.
Oh, hallelujah. Yeah.
They got their sight back because of their faith, not because of Jesus' faith. I've told you before, I'll tell you again, God's mind is made up. When he sent Jesus down here to walk a perfect and sinless walk, he turned the word into flesh, dwelt among us. When Jesus went back to heaven, he turned that flesh into a printed word. The exact same thing that Jesus did on this earth is right here in this book. The things that God did are in the Old Testament. The things in the Holy Ghost that's doing is in this book, and it's in your heart. If Jesus said your faith, then use your faith.
Amen.
Why do I want to take a 17/6-inch wrench and try to get a half-inch bolt off? Ain't going to happen. When I line myself up with that bolt and get the right wrench, bolt's coming off.
Yeah.
When you line your faith up with the word of God, healing's going to fall down upon you. Glory's going to fall down upon you. In the third book of James, James 3, I believe he said something to the effect of, beloved, I will. Or it's wish, but really it's translated will. Beloved, I will above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers.
Yes.
Now, after we get born again, that's God's will for our life above any and everything. How do I know? Because the book said it was.
Right.
The Bible says, beloved, I will. It is my will for your life, after you get born again now, above all things, that you prosper, that you be in health, even as your soul prospers. Would you like to tell me I'll tell you how to get your soul to prosper. Read the book, do what the book says.
Yes.
Read the book, do what the book says.
Amen.
When you hear God, do what God says. You'll prosper. Your soul will prosper. And you know, prosperity, we always think about money. Every time we think, it's a common thing because the word prosperity generally is a financial term. But let me tell you something. When God says prosperity, you know what he means? Prosperity in every area of your life. He wants your relationships prosperous. He wants your job prosperous. He wants you prosperous in your mind and in your soul. He doesn't want filth down in there. He wants joy coming out of your mouth. He wants joy down in your heart and your spirit and your soul. He wants you to be happy in everything that you do. Take our eyes off from down here and put them up there. There's where the joy lies. Now look at this. Then touched he their eyes, saying, according to your faith be it unto you. And their eyes were open. And Jesus, and I love this. And Jesus straightly charged them, saying, see that no man know it. But they, when they were departed, spread abroad his fame in all the country. I got to tell you this again, because I love this saying. Jesus told them, don't go tell anybody what he wanted to see. Jesus hadn't went to the cross yet. So, him being a rabbi or rabboni, and the word rabboni actually means master. Mm-hmm. Not just a rabbi of the local church or the local parish or whatever. Rabboni means a master. What they told at the time, what they were supposed to do was go to a priest and show themselves to the priest and say, hey, I got healed. Now I got to do what Moses said for us to do. They went and told everybody. That's just like today. At the time, Jesus said, don't go tell anybody. They went and told everybody. He told us today to go tell everybody. We ain't told so.
Come on,
we keep it in the wall of the church. It's inside the walls of the church. And we go in there and we hallelujah, amen, and lay hands on. We pray in the Holy Ghost. And when we walk out that door, some reason, some folks leave it at the threshold. They just run off back in the world. You're not going to get healed like that. You're not going to get delivered like that. And you're not going to get anybody born again like that.
Right. That's right. Come on, man.
I'm not telling you to run up here to the corner and start hollering and screaming at people. But I am telling you to live a Christian life, to live a godly life, to live a life the way the Bible says to live, and to show yourself a Christian. Listen, won't not ever have to have anybody say, are you a Christian?
That's right.
What we ought to do is people ought to be asking us, hey, how come you got so much joy when the world's going to hell in a handbasket?
Yes.
How can you stand here with a smile on your face and I feel joy emanating out of you? How? And then you know what we do? We turn and say, can I introduce you to somebody? Can I tell you how I used to be? And because of this man, let me tell you how I am now. You ask me why. Look, brother, you open the door. At least you can give me an opportunity to respond. You understand? I wasn't hitting you over the head with a Bible. I wasn't trying to throw scripture down your throat. But you asked me, so give me an opportunity to respond. And then watch your faith take over. Watch the Holy Ghost come in and just build a wall and a dome right there. And I guarantee you that person will be captivated. And guess what? Maybe set another place at the table. Bring another robe and crown down off. The man just got born again. And that's the only reason we're here on this earth. That's our only job. Our job is, well, we praise and worship God. That's right. And we follow the word. But our number one job on this earth after we become a Christian is to get other people into the kingdom of God just like we did. Yes. And you ever had some, now I'm off subject, but I got to ask you something. You ever had somebody rub you the wrong way? You Christian and boy, you bite your tongue. And I'd like to say this and I'd like to say that. Lord, just let them pray. Lord, give me strength. And boy, they just rub you the wrong way.
Yeah.
But we're Christian, we got to love them. Well, think about this. How many people out there you think you rubbed the wrong way?
There you go.
Whoops, you better get them feet back in there. I'll step on them. Don't shout me down, I'm preaching good.
Come on.
How many people out there do you think I rubbed the wrong way? But yet I'm in their daily life, or I see them once, twice a month, or whatever, and they say, I've got to put up with Larry.
Yeah, come on.
Woo!
Right,
huh?
Come on.
I got to put up with them. Let me tell you something.
Everybody's there.
It ain't them, baby. It's you. You understand? If somebody's rubbing you the wrong way, if somebody's rubbing me the wrong way, it ain't them.
Come on. Tell the truth. Amen. Amen. Look.
It's you. It's me.
Yes.
If somebody's rubbing you the wrong way, you got to grit your teeth and you got to be careful what you say. You understand? When they talk to you, you go, you got to pause about 2 or 3 seconds and pull yourself together and say the right thing. Now, after all, you're a Christian. Huh?
There you go. Amen.
Begin to pray for yourself over that. And let me tell you what will bust the whole thing open. Even better than that, let me tell you what will bust the whole thing open. Lord, you begin to pray for that person.
Yes.
And here's what you pray for them. Lord, pour a blessing out on them that they won't have room enough to receive. Pour a blessing out on them. Heal them and deliver them. Lord, give them more money than I ever thought about having. Give them a better house than I have. Give them a better job than I've got. Give them a better, whatever I've got, Lord, give them double.
Yes, amen.
Huh?
Yeah.
If you want to break that off of you, you pray for that person.
That's right.
And I'm going to guarantee you, now, don't get mad when they start getting blessed. You're going to go, what happened? Brother, you prayed for them. Now listen, the same faith, that you used to pray for them, put it on you now.
That's right.
Amen.
If they're rubbing you the wrong way, you pray for them, let them get blessed. And as you see them get blessed, Lord, can I have some of that? Is there any left over? There you go. Pray for those. Pray for them. Thank you, Lord. I'll take it. All right. Then we're in Matthew. Sorry, got off touch, but I'm on touch. Praise God. Matthew 9:29. Then touched he their eyes, saying, according to your faith, be it unto you. And their eyes were open. And Jesus straightly charged them, saying, see that no man know it. But they, when they went, were departed, spread abroad his fame in all that country. As they went out, behold, they brought to him a dumb man possessed with the devil. And when the devil was cast out, the dumb spake, and the multitudes marveled, saying, it was never so seen in Israel. All right. Where do we want to go, Lord? I got some notes here. Let's go to Mark 11. Now, there was a preacher who's gone home now. His name is Brother Kenneth Hagin. He called this the golden text. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Mark 11. Y'all remember that? That just showed up. Praise God. Matthew 11, 20. And in the morning, as he passed by, I saw a fig tree dried up from the roots. Peter called and remembered, saith unto him, Master, behold a fig tree which thou cursed is withered away. And here it is. And Jesus answered and said to them four words. Keep these words in your spirit all the time. Have faith in God.
Yes. Amen.
My question to you today is, do you really have faith in God? If you did, you'd be speaking. If you did, you'd be standing. You'd find you some of this word, and you'd open this word up, and you'd begin to speak the word.
Yep.
If you can't quote scripture, that's fine. I can quote some scripture, but I don't like to quote some scripture because I want to go to the word and make sure I get it right.
Yes.
Have faith in God. For truly I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast in the sea, shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he says. Yet, are you believing what you say will come to pass? If you do, you'll have whatsoever you say. Now listen, when you stand praying, forgive. Remember, we just talked about that. If you have aught against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. Let me tell you right now, if you've got something to get somebody, you might as well just not even pray. Unless you want to pray, Lord, forgive me for having something against them. I don't care. I forgive them. Remember, pray for those that you got it that rubbed you the wrong way.
Yeah, come on.
You better go to God and cry out. I didn't get to the chance, but cry out to God. If you can't cry out right there where you are, find you somewhere and holler at the top of your lungs. If somebody tells you stop it, you say, listen, I ain't talking to you. I love you, but I'm talking to my God.
Yeah.
Get over here and get with me or get out of the way.
Yep.
Guys, I love you. I'll see you in a week.
Glory.
When the way gets rough and rocky, just look up and you can see what the world